Okay, is my screen visible?
It's loading.
Are you able to see my screen? Okay,
Yes.
good. Right, so we were at raw strings. Next, we come to lists. Okay, so lists are a very useful feature that is provided by Python. So it's basically a sequence of values, just like you have, in C, C++, you arrays. So you can have lists also. Lists, they are always ordered. Okay, they always follow the order in which you define the values. They always come in that order. The list elements, you can access them by using indexing, using square brackets. Inside the square brackets, you put the index. Starting from zero, you put the index, then you'll be able to access the elements of the list. Then a list can contain any type of value. Okay, need not be always numbers. You can have strings also inside a list. Then lists, they are mutable. Mutable means lists, they can be changed. That means you can add new items to a list. Strings are not mutable. You cannot change a string. But a list, you can add new items. You can delete existing item and you can update existing items. Okay, so all this you can do using lists. So now next thing is how to create lists. Easiest way to create list is using square brackets. So all of these are lists, are valid lists. So first one is an empty list. This is a list which does not have anything. Okay. So this is the first one. It does not have anything. So it's an empty list. Next, we have 1, 3, 8 minus 2 minus 9 2. So this is another list. The next one we have a list which contains W, C, and P. Next one will be a list which contains these three words. And then L4 is a list which contains first element is a string. Next element is an int. And next element is another int. This 2020 is also an int. Then this last one is also a string. So you could have any number, different kinds of elements inside a list. But usually that is not advice. Your advice not to have different kind of elements in the same list unless and until you absolutely require this. Okay. So all of these are valid lists. Now next is another way to create a list is by using what is known as a list constructor. Okay, L-I-S-T, list constructor. So this constructor is basically a type of function. There are many different types of functions. One is called constructor, another one is called as method. Methods are also functions. Okay, how do you understand which is a constructor, which is a method? Method functions are always preceded by a dot, something dot function. That's basically when there is a dot function, then that is what is called as a method. Okay, so we have something called as a list constructor. Using this list constructor also, you can create a list. So for instance, let's say L5 is a list which I'm creating using this list constructor. So you call this list, okay, this function, and inside this you put a string. Okay, then that is going to create a list where each and every element will be one member of the list. So you can see here WCP 2020. So it has taken each and every character. W has become one element, C has become another element, P has become another element, and so on. So you have converted the string into a list. Okay, so this is how you can create, this is another way to create a list. Now, once you have created a list, then you can find out the length of a list also. So for instance, this first list, right, L1. Okay, this has got how many elements? We can see here, we can count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It has got 5 elements. You can actually find out the length of element by using the len function. Okay, by using a len function. Okay, the len function 5. It is showing me correctly that this length is 5. Then you could have nested lists. That means a list can contain a sub list. Okay, you could have a list of lists. That is also allowed. Okay, so this generally nested list you can actually use to arrange hierarchical data. Suppose you have some data in which there is some kind of a hierarchy, you can actually do that. So one example that I can think about is the values of NLM, because that there is a hierarchy. When NLM there is a hierarchy, I'm talking about the quantum numbers. So let's say N can take values 0, 1, 2, 3, and so on. For each value of n, then the value of l will be for it will go from 0 to n minus 1. So if n is 1, then the value of L will be 0. If n is 2, the value of L will be 0, 1. If n is 3, it will be 0, 1, 2. Okay, so we could have L as a list of lists. We could have a list of n. We could have a list of n. Okay, so I create a list of n. That means 4 of these principal quantum numbers. 1, 2, 3, 4. I have given these spaces just to, you know, organize this better. Okay, organize the elements of the list better. So we have 4 elements in this list. 1, 2, 3, 4. Now next list is L. Now L is a list of lists. Okay, because you can see here, this is the first element of L, this is the second element of L, this is the third element of L, and this is the fourth element of L. And like I said, lists can contain anything. Okay, list can contain anything. So list can contain other lists also. So we are having 4 different lists. First list has got only 1 element, next list has got 2 elements, next list has got 3 elements, last list has got 4 elements. So all of these individual lists, they are also part of this larger list. So by doing that, I can actually show this kind of a hierarchy. So if I were to now plot this down, so for L, n equal to 1, L is equal to 0, n equal to 2, L is equal to 0, 1, n equal to 3, it is 0, 1, 2, n equals 4, it is 0, 1, 2, 3. So I could actually now print this. So there are 2 ways to print this out. One is, I could use a for loop here. In the for loop, for I equals I in the range len n, okay, you print ni, that means you print each and every element of n, then you print each and every element of l. So let me just comment out this one, just to show you what difference it will make. Okay, so this is what it is giving me. So what it is doing is, I, the value of I is going from 0 to the length of n. What is the length of n? The length of n is 4. Okay, the length of n is 4. So the value of I will be from 0, 1, 2, and 3 only. It will not go to, or it will be 0, 1, 2, 3. Now, then I want to print, okay, n of I. So n of I means n, when I is equal to 0, what is n0? N0, the value is 1, so it is printing 1. Then I want to print L of I. Okay, L of I means, what is the first L of 0? What is the first element? It is this list. So it just prints this list as it is. Then when n is equal to I is equal to 2, I is equal to 1, then n, it will print this one and it will print this. When I is equal to 2, it will print this and it will print this. When I is equal to 3, it will print this and it will print this. So that's why we are able to see this kind of an output. But I can also individually access. So suppose I want to access this one. I want to access this number. I want to access this number. Then I could use multiple indices. Okay, I could use multiple indexing. So that's what is done over here. So here for I, this is the outer for loop. Outer for loop will go over I. Okay, then there is going to be another for loop, the inner for loop. The inner for loop goes over J. And the value of J will be in the range of whatever is the length of Li. Whatever is the length of Li. So length of here is of length of this one. The first element is 1. So the value of J will be only 0. So L and whatever is the I, 0, 0. L, 0, 0. It is going to print the first element. That is, it is going to print 0. Same way, it will go through the other one. Okay. So it goes to the next element. And then over here, it will iterate. This for loop is going to iterate through all the elements over here. Similarly, when n is equal to the next value, then this for loop is going to iterate through all of these values. So when I run this, you'll get something like this. Okay, so I'm able to access each and every element inside this nested list. Okay, so these are known as nested lists. Then you can also index and you can slice list also. Okay, list indexing. Okay, of course, I mean, we have just seen indexing of lists. You can slice the list also. So if I want to one specific element. So let's say this is one list, 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 13, 21. Like some of you may be able to recognize, these are members of the Fibonacci sequence, right? One, every element is the sum of the previous two elements. So one is there, this is 1, then this 2, because 2 is equal to 1 plus 1. The next is 3, 3 is equal to 2 plus 1, right? Next is 5, 5 is equal to 3 plus 2. Then next is 8, 8 is equal to 5 plus 3. Then next is 13. 13 is equal to 8 plus 5. 21 is equal to 8 plus 13. So this is basically your Fibonacci sequence. I've just taken the first few. Now, if I say L6 of 6, that means 0. This is 0, element 0, index is 0. This is index 1, index 2, index 3, index 4, index 5, index 6. So it should display 13. 13 should be displayed. Okay, so first it will display 13. Okay, it has displayed 13. Now, when I do L6 of minus 3, L6 of minus 3, what will it give me? Minus 1 is the last one. Same negative indexing, minus 1, minus 2, minus 3. It should give me 8. Okay, it has given me 8. Okay, so now next is list. You can also slice, you can extract portion of the list. You can extract portion of the list, same way as strings. So if I do L6, 2 to 6. So this is 0, this is 1, this is 2. 2, index 2, index 3, index 4, index 5. Index 6 is here, but it will go only till 5. So it will show you 2, 3, 5, 8. Okay, 2, 3, 5, 8. That's what it will show. So you can extract slices of this. Okay. Then next, you can add new items to a list. Okay, you can add new items to a list using this. Using this method called as append. So let's say in L6, okay, I want to add one more element. Okay, it's a Fibonacci sequence. So after 21, we want the next element. Next element will be the sum of these two. So 13 plus 21 is 34. Let's say I want to add 34 to the end. You can do that by using append. So what append will do is it will add whatever value you have passed inside as the argument. That value will be passed and it will be added to the end of this. When I do this, you see it has added one more element. Okay, so this is if you want to add elements to the end of the list. So that means if you want a growing list, the list to keep on growing, if you want that to happen, then we can use this append method. But you can also insert using at specific locations. Okay, you can also insert items at specific locations. So if I do something like this, insert 4 comma minus 31, what does that do? 4 means it goes to index 4. Index 4 is, this is index 0, index 1, index 2, index 3, index 4. Index 4 is this, right? This is 5. This is index 4. So what it will do is, it will insert number 31. It will insert 31 between 3 and 5. It will insert 31 between 3 and 5. And when we print this out, this is what we see. Between 3 and 5, it has inserted minus 31. So this is how we can insert elements, items to a list. Then you can remove items from list. You can remove item by using this method called as pop. So when I say pop 2, what it does is it goes to the index 2. So I think that's what it does, 0, 1, 2. So it is going to remove this element. Oops. Wait a second. Let me run this from here again. Okay, so 0, 1, 2, right? In this index, at this index 2, whatever was there, 2 was there, it has removed that. So you have 1, 1, 3, and so on. That's what happens here. Then another way to, remove elements will be by using the del statement. So del L6, 3, that means you can go 0, 1, 2, 3. That is going to remove minus 31. When I do del L6, 3, it's going to remove minus 31. So again, you see 3 and 5. This is how you can remove elements using either the pop or the del. Okay, so you can also remove using values. Okay, you can also use this remove. There's a function called as method called as remove. You can use this method to remove by values. Okay, you look for the value and then you can remove that particular value. So let's say I want to remove 21. Okay, this element, it contains 21. I want to remove that. Okay, so how do I do that? I just do whatever is the list is L6, L6.remove21. And then when I print this out, you can see here 21 has vanished. Okay, I could also remove multiple items by using slicing. Okay, and I have to combine that with del. So del L6 1 colon 4. 1 colon 4 means this is 0, this is 1. Index 1, 2, 3. This is 4. 4 is not included. 1, 2, and 3. So 1, 3, and 5 will be removed. 1, 3, 5 will be removed. So at the end of this, the list will become 1, 8, 13, and 34. 1, 8, 13, and 34. And finally, you can clear all the elements. You can remove all the elements by just putting l6.clear. That method you can use, and it's only going to become an empty list. So this is how you can work with list, how you can add and remove elements into a list. Next, I want to check if a certain element, another thing that we are interested in doing is, I want to check if a certain element, if it is existing inside a list or not. So let's say this is a list, OBAFGKM. So what are they? Those of you who will be studying astrophysics, you will know that OBAFGKM, these are the names given to categories of stars, different stars. There are many different categories of stars depending on the temperature. So the highest temperature stars, they are type O. Okay, then slightly lower, then lower temperature, lower than O is B, then A. That means as you go from O, B, A, F, G, K, M, the temperature of the star is basically decreasing. Okay, so this is, these are the categories. So let's say I have a list. In that list, I have these different categories of stars. Now I want to check whether in this category, okay, if B exists, okay, the letter B, does it exist in this category or not? Okay, so I have a if condition. If B in L7, so what it says is, if this element, if this exists in L7, then print that B exists. Okay, if so let me just comment this out and just see what happens here. It says that B exists. Okay, now let's say I want to check if something does not exist, some element does not exist. So I could use the not, I could use a not here. If not L in L7, I want to check if L exists or not. In case L does not exist, I want to print that L does not exist. So that's why we put a not. Okay, so if I don't put this not, then this will not be executed. So if I just keep it like this, then nothing will happen. This statement will not get executed at all. Okay, but I want this statement to get executed. So what we do is, we need to have a not condition. Okay, if not this, then L does not exist. Okay, so I could just maybe modify this. Category B does not exist and category L does not exist. Okay, this gives more context to the output here. Then iterating through a list, you can iterate through the list using the for loop, and in the for loop you can just put, you know, in, okay, you can just put in here and then you can iterate through this one. Do we have this one? Yeah, L7. Okay, L7. I want to you know, print out all of these values here. So all we need to do is, I say item in L7. So what is this item? Item is known as an iterator. Okay, here item is known as an iterator. It could be anything. Okay, you need not name it item. You could call it ITM. You can call it that also. Okay, you could call it ITM also. Anything. So any name you can give. So any variable name you can give here. So basically, what will happen is, this variable will become an iterator. So what will happen is, it will take first, this will take the first element value. Okay, first element value is O, and it will print it out. Then once that is done, when it goes again, it will take the item, will take the next element value and will print it out. Done, it goes again, it takes the next element value and it will print it out. So this way it is going to print out all the categories, O, B, A, F, G, K, M, all of them get printed out here. Okay, so that's about lists. Okay, lists, very useful. You use them everywhere. Only thing is, don't use, always try to have the same data type inside a list. Next, we will go to another very interesting data structure that Python provides, that is known as a dictionary. So dictionary is how Python implements a specific type of data structure. It is called as hash maps. Okay, hash maps are data structures which are available, I think, in R programming language. So Python implements that using what is known as dictionaries. So it is basically a mapping between a set of indices. Okay, so we have one set of indices, it's called as keys, and another set of values. So in dictionaries, it does a mapping of keys to values, the key to the value. Okay, that's what it does. So that means the keys should be unique. You cannot have duplicate keys inside a dictionary. That is not allowed. So every key maps to a specific value. Okay, so let's do that. I'll do this using an example. Okay, then it will become clear. Okay, because right now just by looking at it, the purpose of dictionary does not become clear, but when you see an example, it will become very, very clear. Okay, so let us say I want to build a periodic table of elements. Okay, let's say I want to build a periodic table of elements. So what do I want in that, you know, in my storing the data, what all do I want to store? I want to store the name. Okay, first of all, I want to store the name. Okay, then I want to store the symbol. Then I want to store the atomic number. then I want to store the atomic mass, then I want to store the group, I want to store the period, and I want to store the block. Okay, all these values, the atomic mass, all of these you can get it from here, the PubChem. They have this online periodic table. It's a interactive periodic table. So all you have to do is go here and then just click, let's say I want carbon, you click on carbon, it is going to show you all of these values. Okay, so 12.011 atomic mass units. So 12.011. okay, group 14, period 2, block S, you can check here, group 14. Okay, I think I had used some other. Group 14, you can just count from here, 1, 2, 3, 4 till 14. Period will be 2, and this is the S block, this is S block. So that's how, that's why I have put this over here. Okay, so these are the this is my data. Okay, this is my data, and now I want to, I can create a dictionary. Creating a dictionary will be actually good, because if I create a dictionary, then I will be able to use the same dictionary for maybe some other element also. For, let's say, for nitrogen, I could do that. Okay, so let's just create a variable. I call it as element one. Okay, element one. So to create a dictionary, we use curly brackets. For lists, it is square brackets. For dictionaries, we use curly brackets. Okay, so it's always good to have enter your data in multiple lines. Okay, so first thing that we need to do is we need to store the name. Okay, element one, what is the name? Okay, so what you do is you type the name and then you put what is entered, the value of this name. Okay, what is the value? The name with this one, the value is carbon. Okay, then this is the first one. Next, you put a comma here. Next, what do you want? We want the symbol. Okay, we want a symbol. What is the symbol for carbon? The symbol for carbon is capital C. Next, what do we want? We want the atomic number. Atomic underscore number. Okay, the value for atomic number is 6. Okay, note here, this is a string. This is a string. This is also a string, but this is an integer type. Okay, so we can actually mix. Then next one will be atomic mass. The atomic mass is 12.011. Next we have group. Group is 14. Group is 14. And next we have period. Period is 2. And lastly, we have block. Block. The block is S. It's a S block. This is going to be a string. So this is what we have. So we have created for this element. Run this. It's running perfectly. Okay. So now once we have got this, let's say I want to do the same thing for another element. Okay. Let's say I want to do this for another element. First, let me just see how to access this. So let's say I want to find out what is the symbol for element one. Okay, so I could do that. Print. I want to find out what is this symbol. So ELEN. Then you see, you remember this, right? In list, what do we do? We use this square brackets for putting indices. No, you can put 0, you could put 1, and so on. No, but in case of dictionary, we don't put indices here. In dictionary, what we do is we put the keys. These are the keys. Whatever is on the left side of the colon, that is a key. Okay, this is a key. Okay, these are the keys. So let's say I want to find out. I want to find out to print the let's say atomic number. First, the symbol. Okay, to print the symbol. So what is the symbol? All I need to do is inside this square brackets, I just type whatever is the key. Which is the key that gives me the symbol? The key's name is symbol itself. So we do it like this. Oops, just a second. Element one. It is not able to understand this. Element one. So it has given me the symbol. The symbol is C. Okay, so we can put some, some more text here to make it more understandable. The element symbol is C. Okay, then next we can also print out, we want to print out the atomic number. The element symbol is this one. We want to find out the atomic number. Its atomic number is, now next thing what I want is atomic number. So what I'll do is the key, instead of symbol, I have to use this key. This key is atomic number. So I just replace element one. Instead of the index, I'll use the key atomic number. This is to print the atomic number. Okay, so when I run this, its atomic number is 6 and so on. Okay, this is what you can do. Let's say I want to do the same thing for nitrogen. Okay, let's say I want to do the same thing for nitrogen. Let's say I'm having another element, that is element number 2. Element number 2, the name is nitrogen. The symbol is N. Okay, atomic number is 7. Mass number. And go here. Atomic mass is 14.534. Then the group will be 15 because it goes towards the right side. The period is going to be 2. Okay, and the block, this is the P block. Okay, nitrogen belongs to the P block. Okay, so I didn't have to do much. I didn't have to write the whole thing all over again. I just used the dictionary that I use for carbon, and I just used the same dictionary. That's all. I just used the same dictionary. So now if I want to print for the same thing for nitrogen, I take this print command and I do the same thing, but this time instead of element one, I'm going to choose element two. Element two, and it is going to show me correctly. Element two, the symbol is nitrogen, N, and the atomic number is 7. So this is one application where you can use if you have these kind of things. So another place where you can use, let's say instead of periodic table, another place that you can use is, let's say you want to store the information about, let's say the Lyman series. So this could be a project for you. You can try this out yourself. One idea that I'm putting is, let's say you have these that Rydberg's formula is there. No, from there you can calculate the lines for Lyman series, Balmer series, and so on. No, so you could have maybe a dictionary. You could create a dictionary for each of these lines. Okay, so you could have in that dictionary, so something like this. Let's say I have a dictionary like this. So I have, let's say, a line. The line will be open and close. So first one will be the series. Okay, first is the series. First key is the series. So series could be so line one. Okay, first series. Series is Lyman series. Okay, so in series we have again N1 could be one value. Okay, N1 let's say is one for Lyman series. N1 is one, and N2 for Lyman series, it could be anything above one. So N2 is, you know, I just have two or three or whatever, anything higher than this. So we have this. Then you could calculate what is the wavelength. Okay, you could calculate what is the wavelength. Just I'm giving some values here. Okay, 935, just some values, 935.2. okay, just something like this. Okay, so then you can just print out. Okay, print. Okay, so line one, and inside this you could have just print the series. You could print this out, it's a Lyman series. And you want to print out the wavelength. Okay, the wavelength is this much. I mean, it need not be correct. I'm just giving some values here, and so on. Okay, so you could have individual one dictionary for each, and you can store data for each and every line. You can actually store data. Okay, so that is one more place where you can actually use dictionaries. So extremely useful. Okay, when you're, especially because it's not possible for us to, you can actually store the same thing. The same thing you can do it using list also. So for instance, here, let's say the same data for carbon. Okay, the same data for carbon. That we have the same data for carbon. I could do it using this also. Let's say I call it as element three. It is still carbon. Element three, it is still carbon, but I could do that using a list. That means instead of curly brackets, we have square brackets. Okay. Then here, whatever is the data will become the part of the list. So I don't need the keys here. So I could just delete the keys. So first element is carbon, is the name. Next element is the symbol, which is C. Next element is the atomic number, which is 6. Next is the atomic mass, which is 12.011. Next is the group, which is 14. Next is the period, which is 2. And lastly is the block, which is S. And then we close the bracket here. So this is a list. This is a list. The same thing, whatever you have done here, the same thing in the dictionary, whatever I have done here, the same thing, the same information, it is also contained in this same list, in this very same list. Okay. But what is the difference here? Now, suppose I want to print this. I want to print this. I could do that. Okay. I could do elementary, but because it's a list, I can no longer use these keys. Okay. I can no longer use these keys. You can see here, it'll give me an error. If I try to do this, it'll give me an error here. Okay. I cannot use these keys because it's a list. It's not a dictionary. So let's say I want to find out the symbol. So what is the index? First element, index 0, then index 1. So for symbol, I need index 1. Okay. Next, I want the atomic number. Atomic number is 0, 1, 2. The index is 2. So when I do this, now it's running properly. It is giving me what I mean. But you see the problem here? You can look for yourself, which is easier to understand, this one or this one, which is easier to understand. Obviously, I find this easier to understand because it's not possible for me to remember which index refers to which kind of data. It's not possible for me to remember that. It's much easier if I just say element one symbol, element one atomic number. That becomes more, you know, intuitive, and I can understand this much better. Okay, so that's why dictionaries are very, very useful. Then you can add items to a dictionary. Okay, so you can add some more. Let's say I want to add the electronic configuration in this first list, the first dictionary, that element one. Okay, in the element one dictionary, that is for carbon. Let's say I want to add the electronic configuration also. So ELEM1. Okay, I want to add one more. So all I need to do is just specify what is the key. Okay, first let me just print this out. Okay, print element one. Okay, it is given me this. Okay, so now let me now add this one more key to it. So element one. Okay, so let's say I call it as electronic configuration. Okay, and this one I'll give some value. I think I should have the electronic configuration here. The electronic configuration is helium 2s2 2p2. Helium 2s2 2p2. So I could do that. So I could just use a string. I could use a string. So first is helium. Okay. Helium, then 2s2 2p2. So I could just write as 2s2. Then I need some way by which I can, you know, give some space. So 2p2. Okay. 2s2 2p2. Helium 2s2 2p2. Okay. Run this. Now if I try to print element one. Okay, you see it has got one more. Okay, but of course, sorry, print. You print this. Now you see one more key has come in, that is the electronic configuration, which was earlier. Of course, it was earlier there because I ran it once again. Okay, let me just do this all over, then it'll become clear. Let me run this first. You can see first time around there was no electronic configuration. Now one more field has come, that is the electronic configuration, which is exactly this. So you can add items this way. We can remove items also. We can just suppose, let's say I want to remove the block. I don't want this block S, so I could do that just by using, we can use the pop method. Okay, so you can, all you need to do is element1.pop, and inside this I just put whatever key that I don't want the block. Just put block here and print element one. That's here, block is gone. Okay, block is no longer there. Then getting all the keys. So suppose I want all the keys. I want only the keys. Okay, only the keys that are available here in this particular dictionary, you can get all the keys by using the keys method. Okay, so getting all the keys, so you could do something like this: print element 2.keys. If I do that, okay, it is going to tell me what are the keys. Okay, then similarly you can have all the element values. Okay, so or you could also show this as a list. You could also show the same thing as a list: print list element 2.keys. okay, this will convert this into a list. Here it was showing that this is a dictionary keys, but you can convert that dictionary keys, you can convert that to a list also. Just by using the list constructor, we can do that. Then you can have the values. So you can do that: print, let's say, element 1.values. Okay, element 1.values. It will tell me what are the values: carbon, C, and so on. Okay, atomic number, mass, group, period, okay, and the electronic configuration. You could also, the values also can be written in terms of as a list. You could represent this as a list. So you can use the list constructor to convert this into a list like this. Okay, so it is going to display it as a list. Okay, so you can also get the key value pairs. Okay, the key value pairs. So you could do it like this: print element 2.values. If you do that using the values method, it will print this, the dictionary values. Oh, just a second, sorry, it's items. Okay, it's using the items. So using the items, it will just give you, okay, name is nitrogen, symbol is N, okay, atomic number is 7, and so on. Okay, like it just tells you name is this, symbol is this, and so on. Right, so I mean, what comes to my mind is that movie Agnipath is there, right? So there, Amitabh Bachchan or Hrithik Roshan, he calls this, the name is this, like place is this, like that, the dialogue is there, right? So it sounds, seems something like that. Okay, so you can display things like this. So in a similar way, you can also convert this into a list and display it as a list. Okay, then you can iterate through a dictionary using a for loop. Okay, a for loop, it traverses, by default it traverses through the using the keys. So you could have something like this: so for item in, for ITM in element 2, let's say. Okay, for item in element 2, if I say print item, okay, it is going to print only the keys. It's going to print only the keys. But let's say I want the keys specifically the keys. I could just mention it as keys, but that's the same thing. But suppose I want the values. Okay, so then I have to specify, okay, element to values. This is going to give me the values. Okay, so that's about dictionaries. Okay, so these are some data structures that that are used very commonly in Python. Okay, so I'm going to stop here in this lecture. I'm going to stop here, then we'll go to the next topic. Let me close this. Okay, next topic is Python physical computations in Python. So this is a problem. This is a quantum step potential. I had actually shown this function in yesterday when I was talking about blocks. Just as an example, I had shown this. I have already done the coding here, and I'll just display it to you, because writing the codes right now live, that is going to take a lot of time. So from now onwards, I'm just going to show the code directly. It's already written and it's working here. Okay, so let us say I have a particle of mass m, and it is incident on a one-dimensional potential step. So almost all of you would have probably done this problem in your basic quantum mechanics course. Okay, in a BSc, you would have probably done. Our present fifth semester students, they are going to do this. But even if you have not done this, you just look at it as a physics problem. That's all. Okay, just look at it as a formula. We just have to apply the formula. So the particle has got initial energy k and energy E, and a wave vector k1, which is given by twice m e by h cross. And it comes from the negative infinity and it goes towards positive infinity, and it passes through the step. Okay, on the, and on the other side, it has got a smaller wave vector. The smaller wave vector is twice k2 is equal to twice m e minus v divided by h cross. then there is going to be some of this wave function will be transmitted and some of the part of the wave function will be reflected. So then you can find out the probability, that the particle, if you make a measurement of the particle, what is the probability that it will get transmitted and what will be the probability that it will get reflected. You can find out these probabilities using the wave vectors, and these probabilities turn out to be this. So T is the transmission probability and R is the reflection probability. So you can write a Python program to calculate and print the transmission and reflection probabilities for an electron. Electron mass is this much. The energy is 10 electron volts and this potential step, okay? The potential step is 9 electron volts. That is, V is 9 electron volts and E is 10 electron volts. And the constants are given, H cross, in terms of electron volts, it's given as this. In terms of joule second is given as this, and the charge of an electron is this one if you want to convert from joules to electron volts and vice versa. So for that, what we do is I create a, because you see, if you want to calculate the probabilities, you just look at the formula. For calculating probabilities, what do you need? You need k1 k2, that's all. All that you need is k1 and k2 values, the wave vectors you need. And to know the wave vectors, what do you need? You need the mass, you need the energy. H is anyway a constant. So you need the mass and the energy. And for K2, you need the mass, the energy, and the potential. So M, E, and V, these are the quantities that you need if you want to calculate K1 and K2. That's all you need. So that's why the Q step function, which calculates this, its arguments are mass, energy, and the potential. Okay. Then we are also going to do a square root. We have to find the square root. So if you want to find out the square root, then from the maths package, we're just importing one function. That function is the square root. So that's why I have used from mat import square root. Then h bar, I'm going to use the electron volts values only. So h bar is 6.582 into 10 to the power minus 16. So I'm just storing this value, 6.582 into 10 to the power minus 16. Okay, so let me just make a comment here. This is in electron volts seconds. Okay, so that's the h bar value. Then k1 is very simple, just apply this formula. K1 is under root twice me. So under root, how do you get? We can use the sqrt function. So sqrt, inside sqrt you put 2 into m into e. So it is going to multiply 2 into m into e, and whatever is the result, it takes the square root of that, and that square root you divide it by h bar. The value is given over here, so that is going to calculate k1. Similarly, you calculate k2 using this formula. So twice m e minus v, and this twice m e minus v, it is now passed as the argument of the square root function, and the whole thing is divided by h bar. Once you're done with this, then the rest of it is very straightforward. All you have to do is just calculate t and r. So t is equal to, there is numerator and denominator. In the numerator, this bracket is the numerator. Numerator we have 4 into k1 k2. And in the denominator, we have this k1 plus k2 whole square. Okay. Similarly, R we have the whole thing raised to the power of 2. There's an outer bracket, whole raised to the power of 2. And inside this bracket, we have a numerator. Numerator is k1 minus k2. And we have a denominator, which is k1 plus k2. Okay. So this is going to calculate the transmission and the reflection probabilities. So what I do is, it returns probabilities and I return it like this. It returns it like this. So what are we creating here? You can just see there are square brackets. Square brackets means it is returning a list. So what it is going to do, it is going to create a list using the transmission probability and the reflection probability. It is going to create a list. The first element of the list is the transmission probability, and the second element of the list is the reflection probability. And this list, the name of this list is probabilities, and it returns that list. So you can do that. So now next thing is very easy. We define E is equal to this, H bar is this, mass of the electron is 9.11 into 10 to the power minus 31. I've taken this value here. Then E is equal to 10 into E, okay, and V is equal to 9 into E. Then we have this Q step. We call this Q step, okay, and just a second, I think it should be, yes. We're converting this into joules, right? I think there should be, will this matter here? I'm using h bar, I'm using, just a second, there could be some error here, okay, in the code here. Yeah, h bar, I'm taking it in terms of electron volts. Okay, so if h bar I'm taking in terms of electron volts, then that means E and V, okay, I'm assuming that they are also in electron volts. Okay, so I think that's a problem, because here I'm passing E, okay, 10 into E. When, what is this E? E is this. So that means I'm converting this into joules. The electron volts I'm converting into joules, and then I'm passing and I'm getting some results. I think we should be using this 1.054 into 10 to the power minus 34. Let me just check. Yes. Okay. It has calculated the transmission probability and the reflection probability. It is calculated and it has displayed this. So this is a simple Python code which actually does, which solves this particular problem. Next, we have emission lines of hydrogen atom. Okay, so here again, I've used a dictionary. Okay, I've used a dictionary here. You can see series. Okay, series is a dictionary. So this is the key value. Okay, let me just put this one below the other, then it will become clear. The key is one. When the key is equal to one, it means Lyman series. When the key is two, it means Balmer series, and so on. Okay. So this is a dictionary. I'm using this dictionary to identify which series it is. Okay. And what are these keys? Keys are the lower energy, lower levels. Okay. The lower level values. Okay. So now what we'll do is, in this problem, what you're supposed to do is, it, you want to compute the first five wavelengths, the first wavelengths of the first five lines, wavelengths of the first five lines. So what I do is very simple. I can just create a list. I want the first five wavelengths. Okay, so this is the first line, second line, third line, fourth line, and fifth line. I just create a list like this. Okay, so then what I do is I have to take a printout. The print, I take a print of what series is this. Okay, I take a print of what series is this. So you can see here, this M is the iterator. The first value of M will be one. The first value of M will be one. Then this value of one will go over here. And then it will check in the dictionary. In the dictionary, what is one? One, it, the value of one is the key. If one is the key, the value will be Lyman. So what it will do is it will replace this with Lyman. It will replace this with Lyman. So we will have the first line will be Lyman series lines. Then we have for K in the range 1 to 6, for K going from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. No, 6 is not included. So it will go from 1 to 5. Then N is equal to M plus K. Okay, so if M is 1 and K, the values are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So N will be 1 plus 1 is 2, then 3, then 4, and 5, and so on. Okay, so this is going to ensure that for the wavelengths that we are considering, the upper energy level, the value of the quantum number, that is going to be always greater than the lower energy level. Then we say we have this quantity called as inverse lambda. So all this inverse lambda it will do is it will take M here, 1 by M squared minus 1 by N squared, and it is going to print 1 by inverse lambda, which is the lambda itself. Maybe we could have one more line here. The lambda is equal to 1 divided by inverse lambda. And then here I'm just going to put LMDA. Okay, when I run this, you can see here it is showing Lyman series, the first five lines, Balmer series, first five lines, Prussian series, first five, and so on. For all the series, it's giving me the lines correctly. Okay, so this is an application, okay, another application of doing a physical computation. Next, we come to arrays, okay. Now, so far we have used lists and dictionaries. Now, for doing serious scientific computation, you need something called as an arrays. So arrays are an ordered set of values which are similar to lists. but there are some differences between lists and arrays. Arrays are immutable. You cannot change, okay? You cannot change the array. You cannot add, delete, or, you know, update existing elements. And another difference is all the elements in the array, they must be of the same type, unlike lists, okay? Arrays, all the elements can be of the same type. Unlike lists, arrays can be multi-dimensional. You can have two-dimensional, three-dimensional, four-dimensional arrays, all of these we can have. So because of this multi-dimensionality, you could actually do many of these abstract physics. You can do that using arrays. So the, what is the behavior of arrays? The behavior of arrays is approximately similar to vectors and matrices. Okay, you can perform matrix operations on them. So linear algebra, if you want to do, then arrays are perfect for doing linear algebra. And of course, computations are faster using arrays because the arrays, they have been optimized to actually reduce the resources of your computer. Okay, so in Python, how do we use arrays? How do we get arrays? In Python, we get arrays by importing a package called as NumPy, numerical pi. Okay, NumPy. So NumPy is the name of a package. So we can use this package to create arrays. Okay, arrays can be created in Python using the NumPy package. So now, how do we import? We can import like this, import numpy as np. If you remember, when we discussed packages, I told you the different ways by which we can include a package. So what we have done is we have imported a package using an alias, and the alias is np. So np is the alias, or it's a nickname for numpy. So wherever it sees np, it will know that we are talking about numpy. So now we say md elements module, or itm, for item in NumPy, okay, print the item. We just want to see, what is there in this NumPy. Okay, we run this. These are the things that are available in NumPy. These are the components of NumPy, which are already is there available to us. Okay, lots and lots of functions are and methods are available inside NumPy. We don't have time to actually, NumPy could be a separate workshop by itself. Okay, if you want to understand NumPy, it could be a separate workshop by itself, but we don't want to do that. We're just going to use some of these things, and the other things you can just explore on your own. Okay, so first let's begin by trying to create a two-dimensional array. Okay, so let's say I want to create a two-dimensional arrays with m number of rows and n number of columns. M rows and n columns. So let's give some value. M, the number of rows is 3, and the number of columns is 4. So this is a 3 cross 4 matrix. Okay. So now let's say I want to create a array, a 3 cross 4 array, and I want to fill this up with zeros. You can do that using the numpy.zeros function. So all you need to do is, I have already imported numpy here. I have already imported numpy here as np. So what I'm going to do is I can create an array A is equal to np.zeros. And inside this, I give the argument. There are two arguments. The first argument is a list. And what is the list? The list is, first element of the list will be the number of rows, and the second element will be the number of columns. Okay, so number of rows is 3 and number of columns is 4. And what is the data type? The data type is float. So even though it is zeros, we want this to be interpreted as float. Okay, so let me comment this out and I'll show you what will be the output. When I run this, you see it has created 3 rows and 4 columns. It has created. So this is A. Okay. Now you could also, now you can see it gives points here. So if I remove this float also, we'll get the same thing. By default, it will always create float. 0 dot means it's a float. Okay. It's a floating point number. So even if you don't give this, no problem. Okay. By default, it is float. Default. Is. Default data type is float. But suppose you want integer types only, then you can do the same thing. You can just, you know, put int here, and that is going to create int. You see the dots have gone. That means all the elements, they are ints. Okay, so you can create an array. You can fill this up with zero. Now you can change. Now you can change the values of these arrays. Next, you can create an array which is filled with ones. You can You can actually do that. You can use that this function called as numpy.ones. So I can say np.ones. Okay. And first element, first argument will be again the number, a list containing the number of rows and columns. I want to this. I want this to be stored as an integer type. So run this. It is going to show you 3 rows and 3 columns. All of them filled with 1. Okay. Now let's say if you want to fill with any value, if you want this to be filled with any value, so there are two ways by which you can do that. Okay, two ways by which you can do that. Let's say I want this x to be filled with any value. So one way by which you can, let's say I want it to be filled with 2.3. I want this to be filled with 2.3. So one way that we can do is 2.3.np.ones. I create an array of ones. I create an array of ones. Okay, I create an array of ones. First element will be m, comma n, number of rows, number of columns. Okay. And then I don't give anything because I want this to be float. Okay, so print x. Okay, it has created this. Now I want all of them to be filled with 2.3. So you could do this 2.3 start this. This is going to fill this up. So this is one way by which you can create an array with any values. Another way to do that is you could create, use this function called, the method called as full. So full, when I say 10 comma 2, it creates a single row, 1 cross 10. Okay, you see the first argument. The first argument is a list. Instead of giving a list, suppose I give a number, it will create a array, a one dimensional array. Okay, so it will give you 1 cross 10 array, which is filled with 2. Okay, you can see here it has been filled with 2. Then if I want a 4 cross 5 matrix filled with the value 1.3, okay, I can again use full. Only in this cases, the first element, instead of putting inside square brackets, we use ordinary brackets. This is known as a tuple. Okay, you use a tuple to create this. So it's going to create a 4 cross 5 matrix, which is filled with 1.3. Okay, so these are three ways. Then other way is you can create an empty array. You can create an empty array, an array which does not contain anything. The smallest, it will fill this up with the smallest possible value. So np.empty, just give the rows and the columns. Okay, it'll just fill this up with zeros. I mean, it just depends. Okay, the, yesterday when I was trying this out, it was giving something to the power minus 324. Okay, so you can create empty arrays like this. Then creating a list. Okay, you can create an array using a list also. So you can use the numpy.array function. So using whatever argument you put, whatever list you put as the argument, it'll just convert this into an array. So let's say I have a list. You can see here, you can identify that this is a list, right? Because it begins with square bracket, ends with square brackets. So let's say this is a list. Okay, so I want to print the printer type and then print what is the list. Then what I do is I create another array called, I create an array called d is np dot array, and the arguments I'm passing this list, this entire list I'm passing this as an argument to the array. I'm passing this as an argument. So what it will do is it will create an array using these values. It will create an array. Okay, then I could also typecast, I could also convert. Let's do till here first. Okay, you can see here, this is a list. L is a list. It just shows that it is a list and it's showing me the values here. Then it is showing me, next I want to show what is L. Okay, D, I want to show what is D. D is an array. D is an array. Okay, n dimensional. ND array means an n dimensional array. D is an array and the values of D is this. Now you can see here, the way the lists are displayed and the way arrays are displayed, there is a slight difference. The way lists are displayed, the list, the values, they're always separated by commas. You can see that the values are always separated by commas. But when you're displaying arrays, there is no comma. There's only space. Okay, there's only space between the values. So this is just by looking at it, you can tell whether it's an array or it's a list. But even though both of them, they begin and end with square brackets. But in case of arrays, there is no comma. In case of list, they're separated by commas. Now what I can do is I could just, save this as an integer type. Okay, I could do that. So f is equal to np array. I use the list, but I give one more argument, which is int. Then you see what happens. 3.14. It has taken only the integer part. Okay, it has taken only the integer part, 3. 5.53, it has taken the integer part and has stored it as 5. 9.46, the integer part, it has stored as 9. Minus 1.23, it has stored minus 1. 8.74, it has stored as 8. So it discards the fractional part. It has discarded the fractional part and has stored only the integer part. So this is what happens when you put this keyword int. Okay, so you can create arrays of integer type arrays. You can create it like this. Then you can also read an array from values which are stored in a file, okay? From values which are stored in a file. So let's say I have a file on my system. Let me show you where. Okay, so let's say I have this this file called values.dat. Okay, let me open this values.dat. It contains these values. Okay, 23.8. Okay, don't worry about this. This one is just the line number. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4. Just, these are just the line numbers. Don't worry about the first one. This is 23.8, 23.8. 99.2, let me just give a tab so that it becomes clear. 23.8, 99.2, minus 7.4, 89.1, 46.3, and minus 12.6. So these are the values which are stored inside a file. Now, NumPy, it allows you to read those values. So for those of you who are actually doing this side by side at home on your own PCs, if you're following me, if you want to get these values, you can create a file called values.dat and then put these, or you could just download this from here. This in your schedule for this day two, and a folder has been mentioned there. You go to that folder and some files are given here, values.dat. okay, this is the same file. You can just download that file if you want to get the exactly the same thing. So if you want to suppose load data from a file, you can use this function called as load txt function. So val is equal to np.load.txt, and the argument will be the name of the file. The file name should be here. The file name is values.dat. Okay. Now let's say I have this inside a folder. Okay. Let's say I call it data. Okay. A folder called as data, and I put this values.dat inside this data folder. Okay. This values.dat is inside this data folder. Okay. It should be in the same thing. Okay. Because this one is 20 WCP 20 day 0203. Day 0203. This is the file. This is my notebook file. Okay, when I say values.dat, it means it is assumed that the values.dat file is in the same folder as the that notebook file. This is my notebook file. Okay, this is my notebook file. So wherever the notebook file is, the values.dat is also over in the same file, okay, in the same folder. So now I have created a new folder called as data, and then I have put that values.dat over here. So to do that, to access this, you have to use, I hope this will work, data /forward/. So now it will tell you that inside this current folder, there is a folder called as data. You go inside data and there is a file called as values.dat. Okay, read that. And as you can see here, 23.8, 99.2, minus 7.4, 89.1, 46.3, minus 12.6. Okay, so this is how you can read data from a file. Okay, load txt, that's the function that is used for reading data from a file. Then another useful method is known as the I. This creates an identity matrix of any order. Okay, so if I say np.i, it will create a 4x4, because identity matrices always, they should be square, right? So you don't have to give both rows and columns. If you just give rows, that is enough. Column, number of columns will also be the same. So if I just say 4, it is understood. So when I do this, it creates an identity matrix. You see the diagonals, they're all 1. Okay, so you can easily create an identity matrix like this. Okay, then you might be interested in generating random numbers. Okay, so the NumPy, it provides you a way to do that. So suppose I want to generate a random number from a uniform distribution. So that uniform distribution is from minus 9 till 12. Okay, so it means, let's say from minus 9 till 12, we have all these different numbers, and all of these numbers, when I say, what is the meaning of uniform? The meaning of uniform is all of the numbers between minus 9 and 12, all the numbers have equal probability of being chosen, because that's what random means. No, when I say random means, I'm going to randomly choose a value from minus 9 to 12. So what is the probability of choosing a number? The probability is all the numbers have equal probability. If all the numbers have equal probability, then we have to use a uniform distribution. So np.random.uniform minus 9 till 12. This will give me the interval over which I'm looking for a random number. And when I do this, you see, I get minus 0.16 and 10 and so on. I do it again. You can see it will keep on generating. If I run this again and again, you can see these random numbers, they will never be less than minus 9 and they will never be greater than 12. Okay, it will always stick to that interval. So this is one way by which you can generate random numbers. Okay. Next, if you want, let's say instead of you want a 1x7 array. Okay, you want a 1x7 array of random numbers in the interval. The interval will always be the first two arguments. -3 to 4, that is the interval, and I want a 1x7. So third argument, you just give 7. It automatically understands that there is only one single row. And when I do that, when I run this, you see it has created a one array. So you see all the numbers, they will lie between -3 and 4. Okay, you can do that. So let's say, so where do we use this random numbers? So basically, let's say you're writing a program and you're trying to simulate real life data, real physical data. You can actually do that. You could have some kind of define some kind of an interval, and that interval will be determined by the error, the amount of error that is there of your instrument. And based on that, you could define the interval. Within that interval, it will randomly choose values, and accordingly, you can simulate real data, okay, physical data. So this is, you can generate the 1x7 array. Okay. Next, let's say if instead of an array, if in case of a one-dimensional array, let's say I want a 2x3 matrix in the same interval, -3 to 4, same interval, but it's a 2x3 matrix. Then the third argument will have to put a tuple 2, 3. Okay. And when I run this, you see, you'll get a 2x3, two rows and three columns. You get random numbers like this. Then we can generate a random number from, let's say, in the interval 0, 1. Okay, between 0 and 1, let's say we want. I mean, we need, there are many applications where we actually need to generate random numbers in the interval 0 to 1. Okay, so let's say if you're doing Monte Carlo simulations, right? You need to generate a random number between 0 and 1. Or let's say you're doing a simulation where you want probabilities, where you want randomly, you want to generate some probabilities. So probabilities, the value cannot be more than 1. So this is going to be a good way to generate those random probabilities. So this one, to do that, we use np.random.rand. And when I run this without any arguments, it will just generate one number which lies between 0 and 1. Okay, one number which lies between 0 and 1. Then if I want a 1x6 array, 1 row 6 columns array, then np.random.rand, and I put a single argument 6, it understands that we want a single row. So when I run this, you can see here, I'm getting a single row of 6 values which lie between 0 and 1. Then if I want a matrix, you can just put number of rows, number of columns here. It will give you a matrix, 4 rows, 5 columns, all with random values lying between 0 and 1. Okay, of course, all 0 and 1, it's a uniform distribution. Here also it's uniform. Then suppose these are all real numbers. Okay, these are all real numbers. But suppose I want, integers. I want random integers. Let's say I want to generate random integers between 1 and 9. So for that, the function is randint, random.randint. I specify 1 and 9. And when I run this, you can see here, it will generate just one number between 1 and 9. Okay, so 2, 6, 1. Every time I run this, I'll get some different value. Okay. Now let's say I want to generate the same thing, integers between 1 and 9. I want to generate 1x4, 4 integers. So I put the interval 1, 9, and then how many integers do I want? I want 4 integers. Now when I run this, you can see here, I'm getting 4 integers lying between 1 and 9. Okay. Next, if I want a matrix, then the third argument, instead of a single number, we'll put a tuple. Let's say I want a 4x3 matrix having integers lying between 1 and 9. Do it like this. You will be able to generate random integers lying between 1 and 9, a 4x3 matrix. Then let's say you don't want to do this. You want to give a certain list. Let's say you have a certain list. I have a list. The list is 1, 3, 4, 9. I want to choose a random number from here. From this list, I want to choose a number, either 1, 3, 4, 9, either any one of these, only from this list I want. Then I could do this. I could do a random.choice, np.random.choice, and the argument will be, I'll put that list. The list is 1, 4, 3, 4, 9. Okay, and when I run this, it will select any one of these 4 numbers at random, and it will display that. So 4, it has chosen 1 now, it's chosen 1 again, 4, 9, 4, 3, and so on. Randomly it will choose. Okay, so now this gives us a way. Okay, so now here, random.choice, it need not, this, because it takes a list, list can take any kind of values, so you need not always have, you not always supply numbers, you can supply anything else also. So now this gives me an idea. Okay, you would have probably learned about this in your statistics. So suppose I take a coin and I toss this, right? What is the probability that the coin will get heads? If the coin is fair, the probability the coin will get heads is 0.5. The probability that the coin is going to get tails is 0.5, right? So this is the probability of getting heads or tails. Both are equal. It's a uniform distribution. But suppose I toss the coin, let's say 3 times. Okay, let's say I toss the coin 3 times. Then out of these 3 times, how many times will I get head? Or let's say if I toss the coin 4 times, even number of times. Okay, I toss the coin 4 times. If you can take a coin for yourself and you can try it out for yourself, you will never get something like, you know, two times head, 2 times tails. Never it will happen. Okay, very rare. If you take only four tosses, in 4 tosses, probably something will happen like 1 times head or 3 times tails. Okay, and maybe three times heads and 1 time tail. Okay, or maybe all of the times you'll get heads, all of the times you'll get tails, something like that. But getting exactly 2 heads and 2 tails will become very rare. Okay, but why do we say that it's 50-50? Because when you take extremely large number of samples, like say like 1,000, 2,000, then the overall this probability it becomes 50-50. So if you take small number of samples, it will most probably it will not be 50-50. It will be like, you know, 60-40 or 70-30 or something like that. That will be the probability of getting heads or tails. So we can actually use this to do a small experiment to verify if that is indeed the case. So what I did was I created 2 values, HT, head and tail, HT. Okay. And I put both of them, okay, 2 variables, this will count the number of heads. These are basically number of, it will count the number of heads, or let me say, number of heads and number of tails. Initially, both of them are 0, okay. So now number of turns, let's say I give 5 turns, N is the number of tosses, okay. Number of tosses is five. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to toss this 5 times. So how do I toss this? I can use a for loop. Okay, I can use a for loop. So I in range n tosses. So I will take the value 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. So that means I will take 5 different values. So n tosses, okay, I take this loop. Then what I do is I create a random variable. The random variable is x. Then how do I choose this variable? This random variable X, it will take the value either heads or it will take the value tails. Okay. So what I do is I can use this np.random.choice, and inside choice, because I can give a list and list can contain anything, this list will have 2 values. Either it's a heads or it's a tails. That means these 5 times, when this for loop is going to run 5 times, X randomly, it will take heads or it will take tails. Okay, then I have a if else condition. The if else condition is if X is equal to heads, if X is equal to heads, then the number of heads will increase by 1. Okay, else the other possibility is X will take the value tails. In that case, the number of tails will increase by 1. Okay, so then I want to find out the probability of heads. The probability of heads will be simply the number of heads divided by the number of tosses. Okay, probability of tails will be the number of tails divided by the number of tosses. Okay, so let's run this once. You see, like I said, number of tosses 5, you don't get 50-50, you get 60-40. Okay, let me reduce that, let me make just 3 tosses, right? Run this again. 3 tosses, you see what has happened? Heads is 0, tails is 1. That means all the three times this random this function, the random.choice, it has chosen tails all three times, it has chosen tails. So number of heads will 0 and number of tails was 3. So 3 by 3, it has given 1. Okay, run this again, it will go on changing. Okay, then let's say I make it as 10. Okay, now you see 40 and 60, 60 and 40, 40 and 60, 60 and 40, 50, 50 it has become. Okay, 30, 70 it has become. Okay, so you're not getting 50, 50. Okay, let's make it 100, number of tosses. Now you see we are getting close to 50, 50. See, 52, 48, 51, 49, 57, 43. Now we are getting close to 50, 50. Okay. Now suppose I increase this, I make it 1000. Okay. It's close to 50, 50. 0.5, 0.47 is 0.48, around 0.48, 50, 50. Exactly 50, 50 you got. Okay. Now it's closer to this. Now if I make it 10,000, it'll take a lot of time, but still, let's just try. It has taken quite some time. See, this is 50, almost 50, 50. Okay. Now if I make it, let's say 50,000, let's see, five times. Yeah, it is taking some time. You see, it's almost 50, 50. Okay. So what we have learned is actually correct. You need to have statistically large number of tosses. You need to throw the coin statistically. Either you throw the coin statistically large number of times, or you have a statistically large number of coins and you throw them all simultaneously and count how many heads or tails, or better still, you just write a Python code, which will do that for you. Okay. So this is basically an application of using this random.choice. Okay. Next, let's say the same thing, the random.choice. This is a uniform distribution. Okay. When I say 1, 3, 4, 9, all of this, what is the probability of choosing one? The probability of choosing one is 1/4. Because there are four elements. So 1/4 is the probability of choosing one. What is the probability of choosing three? Again, 1/4. Probability of choosing one, four is 1/4. Probability of choosing nine is also 1/4. So the probability of choosing each and every one of them is the same, 1/4. That's why it's called as a uniform distribution. But suppose, okay, suppose I don't want the probability to be uniform. I want non-uniform probability. Okay. In that case, what will happen? Okay. Now let's take this one. Random np.random.choice. Here heads and tails, they have 50-50 probability. But suppose I want to say that no, this is a biased coin. This is a biased coin. This coin has got greater chances of showing heads. Okay. This coin has got greater chances of showing heads. So I could provide this probability. So let's say the probability that the coin is going to show me heads is 0.75, 75% probability. And the probability that it will show tails is 0.25. Okay. So you can see the mapping here. 0.75 is the probability for heads, because that's the first element. And for tails, which is the second element, the probability of getting tails is 0.25. Now you see, when I take a very large number, first let's take a very small number, it will not be 0.75, 0.25. It will be 0.8, 0.2. Okay. The value is going on changing. Now let's take it 50. It will get closer and closer to 75 and 25. Okay, not so close. Let's take it as 500. You can see here 75, 25. It's getting closer to 75 and 25. Okay, let's bring it as 5000. It gets closer to 75, 25. Okay, so now I have made the coin. The coin is no longer unbiased. The coin is biased. It is biased towards head. There is a larger possibility of getting head. Okay, so you can specify this as the second argument of. The second argument of this random.choice. So suppose I want to choose between minus one and plus one. I want to choose, okay, values with probabilities 0.7 and 0.3. Okay, you can do something like this. Okay, so you could do something like this. Let's say you are trying to do a problem where you are trying to assign some spin to an electron. Randomly, you are trying to give spin to an electron. So if you give 50-50, then there is equal probability of spin plus or spin minus. But you could have a scenario where it is more likely that the electron will have a spin of minus. So in that case, you can assign a larger probability to this. Okay. And accordingly, it is going to choose from that distribution, from that non-uniform distribution. Then, this is one experiment that the same thing, similar to along these lines. So one suggestion that I can do is you could do an experiment just like how I've done for the coins, tossing of the coins. You could do the same thing for a dice, right? You could have, all you need is choice, random.choice, and inside the choice, you have a list, and in that list, the values will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, right? If you don't specify any argument, second argument, then the probability of getting 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, all of them, the probability will be 1/6. Then you could have a loaded dice. What is the probability of getting 6 maybe is larger. So you could have defined such probabilities, and then you can find out if it is indeed giving you these. So you'll have 6 different probabilities, probability of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. You can actually find out. Now here, same thing. Okay. So I have chosen the probabilities to be 0.7 and 0.3. So if I run this, when I have 100 samples, okay, the probabilities are fluctuating. When I increase this, make it 1000, the probabilities are getting closer to 0.7 and 0.3. Okay, close to 0.7 and this is close to 0.3. You can see if I increase this 10,000, it'll take more time, but still 0.7. It's giving me exactly 0.7 and 0.3. Okay, so these are some basic probability experiments that you can do using this np.random. Okay, then array elements. Okay, you can try this out for your own. You can manipulate individual array elements by indexing. Okay, you can do that. First initial array is element is this, so you can find out what is A12. What is A12? A12 is index number one for the rows. So this is row number zero. This is row number one. Okay, so we are talking about the second row. Then two is row number column number two. Sorry, column number zero, column number one, column number two. Column number two is this one. That is the third column. So third column, the intersection of the second row and third column is seven. It is showing me seven. Okay, then you could also, you know, set the values like this. Okay, A12 from 7, I have changed A12 from 7. I have changed this value 2 into A00. What is 2 into A00? A00 is this 2 into 1 plus 3. 2 into 1 plus 3. Now the value has become 5. So earlier it was 7. Now I have manipulated in place and I have made it 5. Okay. So arithmetic on element by element basis, you can have on individual arrays, you can have, you can perform arithmetic on an element by element basis. But for this, the arrays must be of the same size. Okay, very important. The arrays must be of the same size. So let's say I have an array A. Okay, I create an array using this 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, using this list, I create an array. Then this B. Okay, this B is this. Let me just, So let's say I want to find out what is B. Okay, you can see here B, what it does is you are doing A square. So what are you doing? You're actually squaring the array. Squaring the **2 means you're taking the square. So when I say A **2, what it does is it just takes the square of the individual elements. So 1 square is 1, 2 square is 4, 3 square is 9, and 4 square is 16. Okay, so it does this element by element. Same way you could do this for C. Okay, so B has already been created. B is A square. So 2A minus 5B. C is equal to 2A minus 5B. It is calculated C here. Then you could do the same thing for D. D is equal to A plus 1. Okay, this is what D is going to look like. Then we could do this for E. E is equal to A by B. Element by element, A divided by B. Okay, A divided by B. So 1 by 1, right, 2 by 4, 3 by 9, so 3 by 9 and 4 by 16, okay, 1.5, 0.33 and 0.25. Then you could also do the, you know, modulus, you can find out the remainder when you divide one by the other. So only the first one will be 0 because 1 will divide by 1. Remember, B is A square, so 1. Okay, D modulus A. So I don't remember what is D, but this is the same thing. Okay, D is equal to A plus 1. So what are the values of D? D will be 2, 3, 4, 5. So 2, 3, 4, 5, 2 divided by 1, that's remainder is going to be 0. 3 divided by 2, remainder is 1. 4 divided by 3, remainder is 1. 5 divided by 4, remainder is 1. So that's why F is giving these values. Okay, next, dot product. You can do the dot product of the arrays. When you apply this to one dimensional arrays, it gives us the scalar product. So this is done by using the numpy.dot method. Method. Okay, so P is equal to np.dot b.c b and c, that is this array and this array, you're taking the dot product. Okay, so when I do that, it should give me a single number, and that's the number -1570. In a similar way, you can also find out the cross product, that is the outer product. This is the inner product and this is the outer product. So you can do that. Let's say A is this and B is this. C is equal to NP cross A and B. So it's going to do A cross B. So if you look at it as a vector, I cap plus 3j cap minus 2k cap minus 2i cap plus 4k cap plus 6 4j cap plus 6k cap, when you take the cross product, this is what you will get. Okay, now we also know that cross product is anti-commutative. That is, if you change the order, the sign will change. So it is 26 minus 2, 10. First and last, they're positive. Middle one is negative. But if I change the order, it should be other way around. So B and A, if I do this, then it should be minus 26 to minus 10. And that's exactly what we get here. So this is how you can find out cross product. Then you can also, do perform operations like this. When you do the cross product, on matrices, when you do it on arrays, when you do on vectors, it just gives you the cross product. But when you do the cross product on matrices, it gives you the standard matrix product. So if I want to do this matrix, if I want to multiply with this, I have to use a dot here. Oh, sorry, my mistake. This should have been under this. So let me just correct that. This should be under this. Yes. Okay, so when you apply this on the matrix product, this is going to give us the just multiply the matrices. So when I do this, the result will be a 2x2 matrix. Okay, we got a 2x2 matrix. You can verify for yourself. This matrix operation, if you do, you'll get minus 3502. Then you can find out the shape of an array. Okay, you can find out the shape of an array by using w dot shape. Okay, so W, I think we had already defined it somewhere. Where is W? W is here. W is this. Okay, so this is a 2x2 matrix. W is a 2x2 matrix. So when I say W dot shape, it gives me 2x2. Then you could also use NP. Then you can also use that NP dot shape method. Okay, this is also going to give you the same result. You can find out what is our dimensions of an array. There are two dimensions, so it will give you 2. Okay, if it's a 3-dimensional array, it will give us 3. If it's a 1-dimensional array, it will give us 1. Then you can one more thing is you can reshape arrays. So suppose you have a list, it's a 1-dimensional array. Okay, how many elements are there? Elements is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, there are 6 elements. So when I run this, there are 6 elements. Okay, 1x6. Now what I can do is I can reshape this. So suppose I want to take the first 3 and get one row, and the next 3 I want to form another row. That means I want 2 rows and 3 columns. So what you can do is I can use the reshape method, a dot reshape 2, 3. So what it will do is it will take the first 3, okay, it will form one row, and it will take the next 3, it will form the other row. So it's going to change this. You can see here, it's like this. But if I do this 3, 2, it will form a 3x2 matrix. But remember, if you're using the reshape, sum of these two, whatever arguments you're giving, the sum of these two arguments must be equal to the length of whatever you're trying to reshape. So when I do this, it creates a 3x2 matrix. Okay, but or instead of doing it this way, you could also do it in one single line, np dot array. Okay, this one is going to create an array, and after that you could put a dot reshape 3, 2. This is going to reshape this. So 1, 3, 5, 7, 9, 11. Okay, so this will be the elements. Then suppose I want to let's say I have an array A, and then what I do is I say B equals to A. Okay, let's do this. I have an array A. A is equal to np dot array. I use this list to form an array. Then what I do is B is equal to A. Okay, then what I do is B is equal to A. And then let's say I do print of A. So A is equal to 1, 3, 2, 6. Okay, now let's say I print B also. B is 1, 3, 2, 6. Okay, so now let us say I change the value A. Okay, I change the value of one of these elements. So what is A1? A1 is this. This is 0 index. This is index 1. This is index 1. A1 is 3. So what am I doing is A1, I'm changing it to minus 7. So this 3 will get replaced with minus 7. So when I run this, you'll see exactly that. 3 has got replaced with minus 7. But now, but B we have not changed. No, we did not do anything to B. B was equal to A, but we did not do anything to B. So B should still remain 1, 3, 2, 6. That's what we expect, right? But let's see if that really happens. So when you do that, we find that B has also changed. The reason is whenever we say B is equal to A, we are only creating, we are not creating a new copy. Okay, we are just saying that A and B are referring to the same memory location. So this is one way by which NumPy can actually efficiently use your memory. It does not keep on creating new copies of the same array. It will just refer it to the same memory location. So because I have modified this memory location, so B also is going to show the same change. So what if I want another copy of B, which does not get changed? Okay. So in that case, there are, you know, there are two ways, there are two solutions. First solution is I multiply to B, I multiply one. Okay. Instead of saying B equals A, I say B equals one into A. So in that case, this will work. So again, I create this. Okay. So let me just comment out this line first. Okay, so now both of them are same. Both of them are same. Now let's say I change this. I make A 1, I make it minus 7. Now let me run this. Only A has changed. Only A has changed. B has not changed. Why? Because by writing 1 into A, I'm not, you know, referring to the same A. I'm, you know, creating a new copy. This is one way by which you can create a copy. Another way by which you can create a copy is by using that numpy.copy function. So it also does the same thing. So all you do is b equal to np.copy of a. So this is going to do the same thing. Okay. Next, there are some built-in functions, very useful. You can find out the sum of all elements, but just by using the sum. Okay. So sum a, that is going to give you the sum, which is 2. Sum of all elements of a, which is 2. Is it true? Yes. Because 1 minus 7, 2, 1 plus minus 7, 1 minus 7 plus 2 plus 6 is going to give us 2. Then you can find out the length of the array. The length of the array is 4. So this gives us a way to find out the arithmetic mean. So you can very quickly find the arithmetic mean. Suppose an array is given, you can find out the arithmetic mean simply by sum of x divided by length of x. Because sum of x will give us the sum of this. Length of x will give us how many elements are there. After all, that's what arithmetic mean is, right? So let me just display the mean here. Okay, the mean is 8. You can verify for yourself. The mean of this will be 8. Okay, so now NumPy, you can use this for creating. This is important. You can create more precise arrays apart from what we have seen here. You can create more precise arrays using NumPy. Okay. So in NumPy, there are mainly two functions, Arrange and Linspace. These are the two functions that I use. So the theory behind that is this. So suppose I have an interval A, comma B. Okay. So now A is now, this interval is now divided. So we are dividing into many smaller subintervals. Okay. So the subinterval size is, let's say, delta. Okay. So then how many intervals have we created? All you need to do is the total interval divided by the subinterval. That is going to give us the number of subintervals. Once we get the number of subintervals, then we can find out the data points. The first data point obviously will be A. The next data point will be A plus delta. Next data point will be A plus 2 delta, plus 3 delta, plus 4 delta, and so on, until you reach A plus N delta. Okay, this must be A plus N delta. Let me just clear. This will be A plus. Okay, this is A plus N delta, which is equal to B. Okay, so if we want to create such a division, okay, then we can use the numpy.arrange function. Okay, numpy.arrange function. That means you know what is the step size. This is the step size. The step size is delta. You know what is delta. If you know what is delta, then we can use the numpy.arrange. So you see, if you want to create this subdivision, there are two things. Either if you know n, either you should know n or you should know delta. Either of these two you should know. So if you happen to know delta, that is the step size in how much steps. From here to here, the step size is delta. From here to here, the step size is delta. So we have same step size. So if you know the step size, then we should use this function called as arrange. But on the other hand, you can take this delta here and n here. Instead of the step size, if you know how many intervals are there, okay, how many intervals are there, then you can use this function called as a linspace. So this will give you data points. Okay, the number of data points are known, then you can use linspace. So let's have a look at this arrange. The syntax is numpy.arrange. You give the starting value, then you give the stopping value, then you give the step size, and then if required, you can give the data type. Okay, so by default, the step size is 1. So even if you don't give a step size or data type, okay, it will still, you know, take only the starting and the stop values are enough. So when I say suppose like this, A equals np.arrange 1 comma 10. Okay, the step size is 1. So 1, what will be the next element? The next element will be 2, because the step size is 1. So 1 plus 1 is 2, 2 plus 1 is 3, 3 plus 1 is 4, and so on. So it creates this one, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Okay, now Let's say I want to give the step size now. I don't want the step size to be 1. I want the step size to be half. That is, I want 1, then 0.5, sorry, 1, 1.5, 2, 2.5, 3, 3.5, and so on. Then I could give the third argument. The third argument is the step. I'll make it as 0.5. And when I do this, you can see here, it will create those steps that I'm looking for. Okay. Also, one more thing is the stopping value. The stopping value is not included. Okay. The stopping value is not included. The stopping value is 10 here. So it will go till 9. Okay. Here it's 10. It will go till all the way till 9.5. It will not include the stopping value. Okay. So this is by changing. So you can change more precise. You can have, you could have 0.1. You could have, you can see a very large number, right? You could have something like this. So 0.5. Okay. Then the linspace. Okay, like I said, instead of knowing the steps. So here, A range, when do we use? If we know the step size. If the step size is known, you use A range. But instead of step size, if we don't know the step size, but rather if we know the number of data points, in that case, we use this linspace. So again, its syntax will be starting value, stopping value, and then the third argument will be the number. That is this small n. This small n will be the next argument that you have to put and followed by the data type. So I do the same thing. np.linspace 1, 10. Okay, I did not mention any number of data points. When you don't mention any number of data points, it will assume that the data points are 50. Okay, it will assume 50 data points. So it will divide 1 to 10, it will divide into 50 data points. Okay, so if you count this, there are actually 50 data points. Okay, you can see that for yourself. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Sorry, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, right? And this is going to be 60, and this is going to give us total 50. So we have two more over here. So this is going to give me a total of 50 data points, okay? So if the number of data points is known, we can use linspace. But let's say I don't want 50 data points, I want 25, then you can just give one third argument. The third argument will divide it into 25 data points. So when I do this, the number of data points, it becomes 25. Okay, linspace also gives you the facility you can include, but you can also note down here the endpoint has been included. The endpoint has been included, right? Endpoint is 10, it is included. A range, the endpoint is not included. It's 10 here, the last value is 9 here, and it is 9.5. The endpoint is not included, but linspace, the endpoint is included. You can choose to exclude the linspace. I mean, the endpoint, you can choose to exclude it also. Okay, you can do that by there's one more argument called as endpoint. If you make the endpoint true or false, that is going to exclude the endpoint. Okay, so this is just a demonstration. What I did was I have divided from 0 to 10. 0 to 10, I have divided into 8 intervals. 0 to 10, I have divided into 8 intervals. Okay, I want 8 data points between 0 and 10. Okay, because n I have put over here. And the endpoint, I have kept it as true. Even if I don't keep this, doesn't matter, by default it is true, then it will include 10. Okay, but in the next line, x2, this is an array in which endpoint is false. If it is false, means it will not include 10. Okay, then what I did is just wanted to show you graphically what happens here. I just did a plot here. I just did some plotting. Don't worry about this. You'll learn how to do this plotting very soon. Okay, now let's run this and show you graphically how this works. You can see here 8 divisions. So this one, you can see here, this is x1. Okay, this blue ones are x1. This blue represents x1. Okay, the blue points represents x1. So you can see here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 8 data points. N is equal to 8 data points. For x1, endpoint is true, so it has stopped at 10. For x2, the endpoint is false. So what it has done is it has again created 8 data points, but it did not include 10. So 0, so this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 8. If you make it 10, you'll see the same thing. Okay, same thing over here also. 5 data points. Okay, number of data points, it will not compromise. Number of data points that you want, it will give. Only thing is whether the endpoint is included or it is not excluded. So graphically, you're able to see what's happening here. Then one more is log space. Okay, log space is just like linspace. Okay, log space is just like linspace. In fact, you can do log space using linspace. That is, if you want, this is linear spacing. You can see here, the spacing is linear between any two points. You see, the separation is the same. Same separation. This, because the spacing has been, it's a linear spacing. Okay. But in log space, you can have logarithmic spacing also between the points, between the data points. You could have logarithmic spacing also. So you use, generally we use log space if the data set, the range is extremely large. Let's say I have a data set, the range is from 1 to 10,000, let's say. Okay, let's say I have data from 1 to 10,000. Then it is not possible for me to plot 1 to 10,000 in the same plot. In a linear plot, it's not possible. So in that case, what we can do is we can use the powers. The power of 1 is 0 and the power of 10,000 is 4. So 0 to 4. So 0 to 4, we'll take the powers and we'll divide those powers linearly and we'll put them back. Raise 10 to whatever we have got, and that is going to give us a logarithmic spacing. Okay, so this is log space. The syntax is exactly same as lin space. Syntax is exactly same. Start, stop, number of data points, data type, and then it gives you one more control. What kind of base you are going to take? The default base that we have is base 10. And the default number of data points is 50. Okay. So I'll show you the difference. Okay, let us say from 1 to 10. Okay, let's say 1 to 10. I have, 1 to 3. So from 1 to 3, I have created 10 data points. You can see here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So I have created 10 data points from 1 to 3 using lin space. Okay. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a copy. I'm going to create a copy of, X1. So Y1 is a copy of X1. Okay. Then for I in the range, okay, length of X1, that means I go from all the, for all the values of X. Then what I do is y1 of I is equal to 10 to the power x1. So here, what is this? This is x1 is 1, right? x1 of x1 of 0 is 1. 10 to this, 10 to the power x1. So here, what is this? This is x1 is 1, right? x1 of 0, x1 of 0 is 1. 10 to the power 1 is 10. So the first value will be 10. Next, what is the next one? 1.2222. So next point will be 10 to the power 1.2222. Next is 1.4444. So it will be 10 to the power 4444. Next, 1.666, 10 to the power 1.6. So it will take each and every element of this and 10 will be raised. So what will be the last one? The last one is 3. So what is 10 to the power 3? It is 1000. So essentially, Y will take the values from 10 to the power, from 10 to 1000. Y is going to take the values from 10 to 1000. Okay. So let me just run this and show you. Y is going to take the value. Starting value is 10 and ending value is 1000. Okay, so these are the values. This is not linear. This is linear. The powers have been linearly distributed, but the actual values, they are not linearly distributed because you see the spacing 10 to 16. This is, from here to here, the distance is 6. From here to here, 16 to 27, the distance is 11. So this interval is 6, this interval is 11. So you can see the interval size is going on increasing. So this is not a linear distribution. This is a logarithmic distribution. So whatever value I have got here, instead of doing it like this, you could just call the log space. You could just use the log space here. You can see the result will be exactly the same. Same result in both the cases. Okay, so you can understand log space in this way. So log space is basically linear spacing only, but only thing is you are just taking linear spacing of the powers of 10. Okay, now you could also have base 2 also. Instead of base 10, you could have base 2 also. Okay, then that is going to, what it is going to do is if you take base 2, then the values of y will be 2 to the power 1, 2 to the power 1.2, 2 to the power 1.4, 2 to the power 1.6, and so on, 2 to the power 3. So from 2 to 8, it will distribute from 2 to 8 in a logarithmic manner. Okay. Now at the same thing, the same how I have graphically shown it here, you can see here, this is here in case of lin space, we have a uniform distribution. In case of log space, it will no longer be uniform. It will be non-uniform. You can see here, they are closer initially, but as you move forward, they become far and far apart. They're getting farther and farther apart. This is if you don't include the endpoint. This is if you include the endpoint. Okay. So this is the graphical representation of lin space and log space. Okay, so we have it's 3:13 now. I would like to start a little bit of your visualization. So maybe if you could take a break of maybe a couple of minutes, Samrat, are you there?
Yes.
Yeah. So maybe you can take a break of a couple of minutes, and then I'll start with the next one. That is plotting of data in Python. So we will meet. Okay. Let's say it's now 3:14. 3:20. Let's meet at 3:20.
Yes, next week.
Okay. Okay. So we'll meet at 3:20 again. Short break. Okay, welcome back everyone. So I think we can start again. I'll just take maybe another 15-20 minutes because I'd like to introduce to you the visualization, how to get started with plotting, because we have seen data structures and we have seen how we can create arrays and so on. Now is a good time to actually introduce you to plotting using Python. So let me just share my screen. Okay, Samrat, just let me know if you can see my screen.
Yes, it is visible.
Okay, so now, finally, what we'd like to do is we should be able to visualize our data in Python. Okay, so it means, in other words, we're interested in plotting data. So plotting is done using a package called as matplotlib. Okay, a package called as matplotlib. And this package I showed some time back. Packages, they have modules. So this matplotlib package has got a module called as pyplot. Okay, so this pyplot, it contains all the functions that you require for plotting your data in Python. Okay, so the pyplot, it provides you with methods which are very similar to Scilab or MATLAB. So if you have used Scilab or MATLAB, the kind of plotting that you did, you'll find it to be very similar using pyplot. It's very, very similar. So you can find extensive documentation on this package at matplotlib.org. It contains almost like everything. If you are a newbie in plotting, you can actually just go to their website and you'll have lots and lots of documentation, examples and tutorials and so on. So examples, you could just see, suppose this is the easiest thing to do actually. Whenever I'm trying to plot, let's say some kind of plot, I always go to matplotlib.org. I go to the examples and I see what kind of plot I'm looking for. Okay, what kind of plot I'm looking for. So let us say I'm looking for a plot that looks like this. Okay, so, or let's just go through all the plots. So many different kinds of plots are there. You can plot images also, actually. You can plot image, you can clip images, all of this. Lots of different things you can actually do using matplotlib. You can see here a huge variety of different kinds of plots you're having here. Okay, so you can actually go through this. I mean, you can just keep scrolling down, you see. So many different ways are there. So many ways and means of making plots are available. So this course, you can make this polar plots also. Okay, you can make polar plots also using this, and you can have plots with animations also. You could have, okay, animated histograms and so on. So all this wide variety of problems, you can do this. Just wanted to show you what kind of this you can have. These are three-dimensional plotting. Okay, all these examples are there. So usually what I do is, the easiest thing for me to do is, whenever I'm trying to make a plot, I just go to matplotlib, or let's say I'm trying to plot something like this. Let's take some simple plot somewhere in the top. Let us say I want to plot something like this. Okay, two different signals. Okay, two different plots. Upper plot will have, let's say, a couple of signals. Lower one will have some other plots. So let's say I want to plot like this. Okay, this kind of a plot, let's say I want. So you can go through, the code is here. The code which you can use to generate this plot is over here. So I just do a correlation here. Okay, there's a time here, frequency here. So these labels and all, where do I have to put? I just see here in the code and I just substitute them. And that is going to give me the plot that I'm looking for. Okay, so lots of examples. Then you have lots of tutorials. If instead of doing this is a shortcut way of doing this. Okay, examples is, if you don't have much time and you just want to quickly plot this, go to examples. Choose the plot which seems very close to what you have in mind. Take the code and customize it and make it your own. Okay, that's the fast way of getting plots. Then tutorials is, if you want to learn from scratch. Okay, if you want to learn matplotlib properly right from the scratch, then it says it, you can go through the tutorials. You have introductory level, then you have intermediate level, then you have advanced level. Okay, then choosing color maps, if you want to have different kind of color maps, you can choose that. So many different topics. There are very, very good, nicely written articles which are available. Okay, so you can go through these. Then documentation, the documentation, they have lots of documentation in the form of wikis. They have lots of documentation. So lots of resources are actually available in the website itself. So matplotlib.org. Okay, just feel free to go to this one. In case of Jupyter Notebook, Matplotlib, it comes bundled with it. So you don't have to install it separately. Okay. So now the hierarchy of functions in Matplotlib. So Matplotlib, like I said, it's the package. Okay, Matplotlib is the package. Then pyplot is the module. And inside pyplot, we have all these different functions. We have this variable called the py, which stores the value of pi to a very high degree of precision. Then we have sine function, we have cos function, we have exponential function, and so on. So if you want to access any of these functions, we can use the dot operator. The dot operator is used for resolving the hierarchy. So if you want to access, let's say, the cos function, if you want to access the cos function, the cos, which is there inside pyplot, okay, it's not cos. I need to change this. It doesn't have sine or cos. Let's say plot show scatter im show all these. Okay, let's say you want this plot extremely sorry about that error. Okay, so these are the functions, because those functions which I have written, those are the functions from the NumPy package, not from Matplotlib. Okay, so we have all of these. So suppose I want to do a scatter plot. So how do I access it? We have to do it as Matplotlib. Outermost high level is Matplotlib dot, next one is the module, which is pyplot. So Matplotlib dot pyplot dot scatter. So this is how we'll do it. Matplotlib, the outermost, dot pyplot, it goes to the module, dot scatter, it goes to the function. So you can use the dot operator to resolve the hierarchy. Or easier still, because you don't want to keep on typing matplotlib.pyplot, so it's easier if you just give it an alias. Okay, so the entire thing, matplotlib.pyplot, this entire thing, okay, the matplotlib.pyplot, this entire thing, I'm just calling it as plt. So then after that, if you want to use the scatter function, all you have to do is just put plt.scatter, and same thing for the others. So this is how you have to resolve the hierarchy of the functions that we are trying to use here. Okay, so now let's go to the most basic plot. I'll start right from the scratch how to get started with the plotting. Let's take the most basic plot. The most basic plot is, suppose I have a list. Okay, I have a list of values and I want to plot this list of values. So let us say I have a list which is y. I call it as y, and let's put some numbers over here. So it's a 1.0, then 2.3, 2.6, and 5.4. Let's say minus 1.8, minus 6.3. Let's say I'll put one more, 4.7. Okay. So I have created a list. You can see here, this is a list, right? This is a list. Okay, list contains values. The values are these. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So I have put 4, 6 points over here. Now I want to plot them. So all you need to do is just plt.plot. Okay, I have to, you know, import this one. So import matplotlib.pyplot as plt. Matplotlib.pyplot as plt. Y is equal to this list. Now plt.plot. Okay, because I'm using this alias, so plt.plot, and inside this just put y here. Okay, and then we call the show function plt.show. So this plot, the plot function, it creates a plot, and the show function, it shows the plot. Okay, now I'll show you, there's a difference between this in working with an IDE and working with Jupyter Notebook. I'll show this. Let's just plot this first. So this is what the plot, this is how it has looked like. Now what will happen if I don't put this show? It will still plot this, but there's going to be a difference. If I don't put this show here, if you see this, it has printed out something like this. Okay, it has printed out that there is a plot, and this plot is, it has given some junk, but this is not junk. You can see here OX. OX means hexadecimal. That means this is a memory location. It is basically telling you that your plot is stored in a memory location. It is stored at this memory location. The plot that you have tried to make, it is stored at this memory location. So if you just say plt.plot, Jupyter Notebook will display this one. So if you don't want this line to come, if you don't want this line to come, you can just put plt.show. And there is another reason why we need always need to put plt.show. I'll tell you. Okay, then this is going to vanish. So now you can see here, this is just giving me the plot. So how, what is this plot exactly? It just takes this value. So first value, what is the first value? The first value is 1. Okay, first value is 1. You can see here, the first value is 1. Next value is 2.6. 2.6 is over here. Next value is 5.4. Right, it's 4. 5 is somewhere. 5.4 is this. Next value is -1.8. So this is 2. It should be close to -2. This is -1.8. Next value is -6.3. It's close to -6. Next value is 4.7. It should be somewhere over here. So it has just plotted these values here. Okay. So what you see along the y-axis, what you see, that is these values that we have. But the question is, what about the x-axis? What is there along the x-axis, right? Can you guess what is there along the x-axis? Along the x-axis, you can see here, this is mapped to 0. This is mapped to 1. This is mapped to 2. This is mapped to 3, 4, and 5. So essentially, along the x-axis, what it is plotting is, it is plotting the indices. This one's index is 0. This one's index is 1. This one's index is 2. This one's index is 3, 4, and 5. So index 5 is this. So if you just give the y values, if you just give the y values, the x values, it will just take as the indices. Okay, so this is the most basic plot that you can get. But now we don't want something like this. We want x and y coordinates together. Okay, we want x and y coordinates together. I've already imported matplotlib as plt, so I can just go ahead and I can create here. So let's say x equals, let's say I create one list. Okay, so if I give two lists, it will create an x and y values. So let's say 0.5. Next is, let's say 1.0. Next, 2.0, 4.0, 7.0, and 10.0. Okay, so these are the x values. And similarly, I'll create another list of y values. The y values are 1.0, let's say, and 2.4, -1.7, let's say, -0.3. I'm just giving values, whatever is coming to my mind, and 4.2. Okay, they should be the same. The length should be the same. Okay, you can check the length. Len x is 6. Length of y is also 6. Yeah, so both of them, their length should be same. Okay, both of them, their length should be same. So now that we're satisfied that the length is same, you can just go ahead and plot them. plt.plot. First argument is x, second argument is y. So now what is it's going to do is, it is going to take all the x values, these values it will take, and it will plot them along the horizontal axis. And these values it will take, it will plot them along the vertical axis. So the data points are 0.5, 1.0. Another data point is 1.0, 2.4. Another one is 2.0, -1.7, and so on. So it will create coordinates. This is one coordinate. This is another set of coordinates. This is another set of coordinates. This is another set. This is another set. And this is another set. So at each and every of these coordinates, it is going to just put one point and join them using a line. So plt.show, if I do, I can find out exactly that's what happens here. This is why it has done. It has just put these coordinates. It does not mean anything, but it has basically just plotted these coordinates. Okay. So we have x-axis. You can see the values of x, 0.5 to 10. So the range is 0.5 to 10. Y values, we have from -1.7 all the way to 4.2. So -1.7 all the way to some 4.2. Okay, so these are the y values along the y-axis. Okay, so this is plotting x and y together. But I mean, these are for this. So essentially what you need to keep in mind is, you could have x should be either, it should be a list, or it can be an array also. Okay, let me show you that. It could be an array also. I'll just copy this from here. Let's say I create an array. Instead of list, I could have an array plot function. It can take arrays also. Let me just import numpy as np. And then x will be equal to np.array np.array, and I'll pass this as the argument. So it will create an array. Similarly, y will be np.array, and it will pass this as this argument. The result should be just the same as before. Okay, so it does not matter. You could either pass a list, you could either pass two lists, or you could pass two arrays. Okay, it will work. I have not really tried if one could be a list, another one is an array. I have not tried this, but we can maybe try this out here. Let's say I take x as a list and y I take it as an array. I don't know what will happen here, whether it will give me an error or not. So you can see x is a list and y is an array. Okay, I don't know if you can plot or not. Let's just try this out. Yes, you can still plot. So it does not matter. Okay, x could be either a list or an array. Same for holds good for y also. Okay, next, I want to plot a function. This is what we are interested in. We want to plot a function. Okay, so how do we plot a function? So we'll get a simple function. So let's say I want to plot, let's say the sine x. Okay, the simplest thing that we can do. So again, let me just import. I don't need to, but just, you know, just for so that this code looks good. Matplotlib.pyplot as plt. Import numpy as np. Okay, so we have imported this. Now we are going to create x. No, so I want to plot x, this one, the sine function. I want to plot from 0 to 2 pi. Okay, I want to plot two cycles. I want to plot one full cycle of the sine function, that is 0 to 2 pi. Or let's plot two cycles means 0 to 4 pi. Okay, I want 0 to 4 pi, 100 divisions. 0 to 4 pi, I want 100 divisions. So we know that if I have the starting point and the end point, right? I want from 0 to 4 pi. How do I get pi? I can just put np.pi, 0 to 4 pi, and I want 100 divisions. So if I know the number of data points, if I know the number of data points, we know that we can just use np.linspace. Just now we saw that you can use linspace if the number of data points is already known. So x is equal to np.linspace. This is going to create that array. This is going to create an array of 100 points, array of 100 points, which spans 0 to 4 pi. Okay, two cycles it should be. Then y is very easy. All we need to do is y is equal to, y will also be an array, np.sinx. This is going to create the y. Now we can just go ahead and we can plot this. plt.plot x array and y array plt.show. So this gives me the two cycles that we are looking for. So this is how you can plot using a function. Okay, then another thing that we are interested in, if suppose I want to plot, I want to create a growing list, a list which keeps on growing, and I want to plot this. Can we do that? Yes, we can do that. Okay, very easily. So again, I have imported matplotlib and numpy. So let's say x points. Let's say I want to plot the Gaussian function. Okay, let's say I want to plot the Gaussian function. That is y equal to e to the power minus x square. Y equals e to the power minus x square. Okay, let me just add this here. Example, in this example, we are basically plotting y equals e to the power minus x squared. Okay, so this is what we are trying to plot over here. So to do that, what we'll do is I'll just create two empty lists because I want to create a growing list, right? The list should grow. I could do that. Okay, as and when number values are being calculated, the list will grow. So I'll create x points. I'll create one list, and y points, I'll create another list. Okay, so x points and y points. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to go from this one, 0 to, let's say, sorry, I want to do this, this Gaussian, I want to go to this Gaussian, this, this Gaussian function, over, let's say, the values of x will be, let's say, from minus 5 less than equal to plus 5. From minus 5 to plus 5. Okay, let's say I want to plot this from minus 5 to plus 5. Okay, so we could do it this way. For x in I could just directly call the len space, because this after all is just going to create an array for x in len space. Okay, the len space, the values are from -5. Okay, let me give some values here. So a is equal to -5 and b is equal to +5, so that I could change this whenever I want. So len space a, starting values a, ending values b, and I want, let's say, 300 divisions. Okay, I want 300 divisions. So this, that should do it. It will create a array. It will create an array starting at -5, ending at +5, and containing 300 data points. And this x will iterate through all of these points. X will iterate through all of these points. So I could do this in a shortcut like this. Okay. So then what we can do is x points. Remember, x points is a list, and we can add elements to a list. How do you add elements to the end of the list? We can use the append method. Okay, you can use the append method. So what do you do? So whatever is the value of x, okay, whatever is the value of x, I just append it to x points. Now we need this one. We need to find out the Gaussian. So I could define a function def y. Okay, def y, and the value will be x. The left y is value is x, and I'm going to return. Let's say I'm importing import from mat, import the exponential function exp, then return the exponent exp of minus whatever is the x squared. Okay, so this is going to calculate this e to the power minus x squared. I'm calculating over here using this exp function from math. Okay, so I have defined the function like this. Now it is very simple. Now the rest of it is very simple. X points, so whatever is the x value, it will get added to the end of this list. Next x value will get added, next value will be added, next x value will be added. So as the list grows, as you go through this array, this x points list will grow. Simultaneously, we want the y points list also to grow. So y points, okay, also I want to append. Okay, now what do I want to append? I want to append y of x. I have already defined what is y. Y of x is this. So y of x is what I am appending over here. Once that is done, now what we can do is we can just plot them. plt.plot x comma y, plt.show dot this. This seems to be an error. Let's see. Argument must be a string or a number, not a function. Okay. Let me just see if we can, where we have gone wrong. Let me call this as fun. Y equals. Oops, mistake. Yes. No, it has not given me any values. This is interesting. Let's see where I have gone wrong. So I have created this. A is this, B is 5, okay, 300. Okay, let me just do this. I'll just get rid of this function and do it. Let me just do it for sine. Let's see if this works. I'll change the function and just see. Let's do a sine function and see if this works. That's a cos function. Cos of x over, let's say 0 to 6 pi, let's say 0 to 6 pi. 6 pi. Okay. So A is 0. A is 0 and B is 6 pi. So we have x in Lin space 0 to 6 pi 300. Okay, this is fine. Let me delete this. Y is this. X points append this. Okay, now let me just call the np dot sin x. I hope this will work. Np dot, sorry, cos x. Np dot cos x. Oh, sorry, this is my mistake. I realized my mistake here. This is perfectly fine. This is working. Only mistake is I have tried to plot x and y, whereas I should be plotting x points and y points. That's the mistake. X points and y points. No, again. Float object is not callable. Trace back, it goes from line 12 here. Oops, sorry. Y is equal to this. Okay, this is working. Yeah, so I don't need this. I don't need this. I will just have call this as Y. Yes, this will work. Y of x. So this was originally the mistake that I had made was in the plot, the arguments were simply I had put x and y, which is not allowed. Okay. So this is the Gaussian function. Okay. It is centered at 0 and it spans from minus 5 to plus 5. So I could just, you know, have something like this. I could have an argument, the center of this, the center of, let's say, of this, I have another argument, x is 0. Okay. Let's say the default value is 0. Then basically, this one, this function is e to the power minus x minus x naught whole square from minus 5 to plus 5, minus 5 all the way to plus 5. Okay, so this is what I'm trying to do. So x naught default value, I'll keep it as 0. So it, by default, if you don't pass anything, it will take it as 0. Then here I have to change a little bit. So x minus x naught. Okay. Now when I run this, it will give me the same plot because I have not passed any this one reference point. So now let's say I make it as I give the next argument. If I give it as 1, then this one will be centered at 1. You can see this plot is going to shift towards the right side. It has shifted towards the right side because now 1 is the center. Okay, so likewise, I could also pass another argument that is going to give you the spread of this one. So spread, let's give another argument. The spread is, I'll just call it a sigma. By default, the sigma value, let's keep it as 1. Divided by sigma. Okay, run this, nothing will happen. Now if I give one more argument, the sigma value, let's say is 0.5, it's going to get narrower, okay, because the spread is small. If I give 1.5, it's going to become wider. If I give 2.5, it's going to get even wider. If I give some way by which I can control this, the spread of this one, 4.5 even wider, 7 will get even wider. Okay, so this is how we can quickly create a plot. Okay, we just created a growing list, and to that growing, just plotted the growing list. Once we have constructed the growing list, we just plotted the same. Okay, then last thing that I would like to talk about today is plotting from a file. Okay, how do you plot from a file? So let's, I have a file, okay, I have a file which is with me. It's there in that drive, in the shared Google Drive. This file is spectrum.dat. Okay, we want to plot a part of a spectrum. Okay, of a certain from a certain star. This is a spectrum which was generated by one of our students a couple of years ago. So I'm just going to use that data, and I'm going to show you. It's going to show you the absorption line along with broadening. Okay, along with broadening due to various interstellar medium, you will have broadening effects taking place. So you'll be able to see that in this. Okay, so this is actually contained in a file. So let me just open this file and show you. So spectrum.dat. This is the file. Okay, so this is the file. So it contains two columns, first column and the second column. So these two columns it contains. So let me show you how we can go about plotting this. Okay, so first thing, we have imported matplotlib and numpy. Next is we need the data. Okay, we need the data. So let's say data is equal to same thing. How do you load this from a file? Load txt. We did that some time ago using values. Load txt, and then you give the name of the file. The name of the file is spectrum.dat. Okay, just ensure that it is all float. Okay, even if you don't give it, by default it's float, but just ensure that it's float. So let's say we look at data.shape. Okay, so it has got two columns and 227,386 lines, 27,386 rows and two columns. Okay, so this is the data that we are looking for here. So what we will do is we want to plot the x value. So you see there are two columns. The first column will be the x value and the second column will be the y value. So we can just get x and y from here. So data, we'll just use the slicing. If you use just a colon, that means all the rows. Okay, you see, how do you access both the elements? How do you access? So if I say something like this, 2, 1, if I say 2, 1, okay, data is this, and if I say x, okay, it is giving me some value. So what it is giving me, it is giving me row number 2 and column number 1, whatever is the value, it is just giving me that value. Okay, but I don't want that. I want all the rows. I don't want one single row. I want all the rows. Okay, I want all the rows. So how do you get all the rows? You'll get all the rows like this. Okay, now for x will be the first column. So first column, the index will be always 0. So data, this will select all the rows, and this will be the first column. Okay, the next y will be data. It will select all the rows again, and it will select the second column. 0 is the first column and 1 is the second column. Okay, so x and y we have got. Now it's just a matter of plotting them. plt.plot, we'll put the x, y, and plt.show. So whatever is there in that file, you'll be able to see the plot. So this is the plot. So this is the absorption line that we have got here. Along the x-axis, it is wavelength in angstroms. Along the y-axis, it is the flux, the energy flux. And you can see very clearly, you can see that there is a absorption line over here, which has got broadened. Okay, this is a Lorentzian profile. It has basically got broadened due to various stellar effects. So this is how we can plot using a file. Okay, so I think we can stop here. This is a good place to stop. Tomorrow morning when we meet again at 10 o'clock, I will show you how you can now improve upon the plot, how you can make the plot look a little bit better. Okay, how you can customize the plot. Okay, how you can change the color of the plot, how you can put the X label along the X axis, how you can put a label along the Y axis, how you can put a title to this plot, how you can put some kind of a legend over here, how you can change the font that is being shown over here. So all of these things we will do in tomorrow's session. So if you have, anybody has any questions right now, I'll be happy to take that. Any questions? Samrat, are you there? Okay, I guess Samrat is away from his system right now. So if there are no questions, then I think we can end our day here. So yeah, so see you tomorrow at 10 o'clock. I think 9 o'clock is the next session. So see you all tomorrow at 10 o'clock.